Shibboleth. The 15th shloka in the Shloka Sagraha, he brings about that unique concept, Sarva Dharman Parityajya Mamekam Sarnam Vraja Aham Tva Sarva Papebhyam Moksha Vishami Ma Shujaha. One of the very popular shlokas in Bhagavad Gita, very often referred to. The concept that he brought about is about the emphasis on the dharma. Dharma is a very simple concept, yet at the same time, it's a very complex concept. Nowhere else in the rest of the cultures of the world, concept of dharma is not eloquently available, maybe hidden here and there. But then, systematically it has been exposed in the Indian culture, particularly in Bhagavad Gita, he brought about. What is this idea of dharma? Why do we need this concept of dharma? In fact, in a very simple sense, as I said, that it's a very simple concept. You know, like, for example, you are walking in the street, a beggar comes and then he asks for the charity and then he says, do some dharma. That means doing, giving something you seem to be an aspect of dharma. Similarly, this person every festival he goes to the temple, he offers puja, that seems to be the part of dharma. And then also another very simple way that dharma can be used, fire burns. I said, I don't know why that fire burned. Don't say that. To burn is the dharma of the fire. To wet is the dharma of the water. So this seems to be a very simple concept. But at the same time it is a very complex concept in the sense that it is in such a way that he says that you give up dharma so that you go to the reach me sarva dharman parityajya mamekam sarnam vraja, go to me, like that. Lord seemed to be suggesting, which may not be that simple concept. So therefore we need to explore this idea of dharma much more deeply. In fact, half an hour is way too short a time because it requires basically at least about 10-12 hours of exposition to go into the details of dharma. But anyway, let me try to bring about a small little concept of this. In this creation, the objects are there which follow their law. Like for example, water's dharma is to it, flow downwards, water always flows downwards. Does not say that these days, that ecology people are saying that all the water is flowing towards ocean, so let me flow in the opposite direction. Water does not take a course like, recourse like that. Similarly, to burn, teja the fire, stone to be hard. These are all the things which are supposed to be the nature of that particular object. They follow the dharma. Object has a very fixed dharma. When we come to the plants to grow, to give the fruit, it is their dharma. I put the nice wonderful mango seed and then it gives mango fruit. Nice wonderful mango fruit. But then I put the seed something and then it comes out to be a naughty mango. I say no. I put some Alfonso mango seed, but then how did it give naughty mango? It can't give. It does not change its dharma. A rose plant will give rose flower. It does not change. However much the market may be for the lily or the lotus, rose will not change its dharma. This is what is for dharma. This is what is the way that these plants have the dharma. The same way for the bird to fly in the air, to fish to swim in the water, it is their dharma. They don't exchange. They don't see somebody else and then try to imitate that. The fish will not imitate seeing the bird fly in the sky. It is its own dharma. It comes to all these things seem to be very simple, but it comes to the man, then the dharma becomes so much more complex. What is dharma? And there also, we saw variety, very various ways that we refer to it, that father's dharma, mother's dharma, child's dharma, teacher's dharma, student dharma. Like that, there are several things, they seem to be a complex structure that is there. In order to understand that, let's go for a very simple way, saying that animals, they follow according to their natural instinct idea, that is what Bhartrihari says, Ahara Nidra Bhaya Maituranja Samanyameta Pashuvinnarana. There is a very common thing about the human being and the animal is that search for food. When you are hungry, you take food. When you are tired, you go to sleep. Procreation is something which is there both in the case of animals and the human being. But at the same time, and then bhaya, fear, running away from what is supposed to be danger. And then they don't get caught up with anything, they just follow that fear very clearly. They don't abuse themselves. Human being also, when he is hungry, he goes for food, tired, he goes to sleep. So both these things are common in the human being and animal. In what way human being is better than an animal if he is only taking care of these things? In fact, when you look at their 24 hours of the day and then 365 days of a year and then 80-100 years of your life, if you are only pursuing these things like ahara, nidra, bhaya, maithuna, that means where is the question of difference between you and animal? It's all the same thing. And most of the people, they don't realize that they are just only doing that. Maybe somebody is eating in a ordinary plantain leaf, somebody is eating in a golden tree, but that's only the difference. But the food is the same. So when you look at that, your whole life, all education, everything that you pursue in the life, somebody might sleep on a small little simple mattress, but somebody can sleep on a bed which is measuring 6, 8 by 8 feet by 8 feet. I mean, it's something, but then sleep is the same. You cannot change it. So therefore, all these pursuits that we are doing in the form of amassing the material wealth is nothing but taking care of your ahara, nidra, bhaya, maithuna. We are not beyond that. So when you look at it, then it looks very scary, because in what way we are better than an animal? With all the struggle, fight, anxiety, everything, what are we doing? Are we doing anything better than an animal? And not only that, therefore, Bhartrahari says that there is one thing which is human being has much more than an animal. That what is buddhi tesha madhiko visesha. Intellect is something which is there. But intellect is there something to rise ourselves up beyond the level of animals. But if our intellect is used to see that you become more and more an animal, like for example, my intellect is used to see that how much I can abuse myself in the form of food, how much abuse myself in the form of sleep, then in what way that my intellect is useful? See, it is making me worse than an animal. Buddhi tesha adhiko visesha. It is supposed to give me something better than that. But look at the way how we are. An animal does not excess on the food. As much as the hunger permits, the animal eats. Beyond that, it does not want to try to abuse itself. Like for example, you don't find an obese animal in the forest. In the forest, plentiful food is there. And the animal can eat as much as want. But that's not so. Like a tiger kills a deer. And as much as the hunger permits, eats, and the rest of it leaves it for the other animals. They don't abuse that. But look at the human being. He abuses. So much so that you can find obese people eat so much, which is beyond your necessity. In fact, many times we say, yeah, it looks interesting, let us eat. As if eating and hunger are not connected. Or it is time to eat, so let us eat. Or another thing is, anyway, I paid for this, let me eat. In fact, people give all kinds of arguments saying that don't waste food. And if you don't have hungry, don't eat it. Just leave it alone. We eat so much, and to digest that system is really troubled. To digest that, you take the digestion pills and all those things. So look at the whole history. It seems basically that we are abusing ourselves. Nidra, how much we abuse. Animals do not abuse their sleep. Whereas human being is like that. Every other day we get up at 6 o'clock in the morning, 5 o'clock in the morning, rush for everything, and then going to the office, this and that, school. Whereas Saturday, Sunday comes, very 6 o'clock, 7 o'clock, 8, 9, 10, lunch will become brunch, you know, everything, breakfast is eliminated, and lunch and brunch, everything will go to Adigas. So because basically you don't get up. Then even parents will come and say, come on, get up, it's 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock. You know, people say that, weekend, why do you wake me up? Sun does not have a weekend, moon does not have a weekend, no animals have a weekend, no others. Creation and this earth have weekend. Nobody knows what is weekend and weekdays. Our dogs know weekend, because on the weekend we take them to the park. See, they know that today is the day of park. They're very excited. But human being, he says, why do you trouble me on the weekend? Actually, that's why Swami Chinmayananda says, it's not weekend, you are weekend. That means basically that you bring in indiscipline within you. You abuse yourself. Like that, every aspect we are trying to abuse ourselves. Animals have an inbuilt check on that, but human being doesn't have that. And that check, which basically Dharma is supposed to provide us, a check which comes from internal, from inside. Now here, let me try to come a little different in topic, saying that we have laws, we have rules and regulations. In fact, every place where human being stays, then there need to be laws, so that we laws are make our life comfortable. That's what is the idea. You give up something so that you make yourself, you get the advantage of something. Like a very simple law that I can think of is that go on the right side of the road or on the left side of the road, whichever is country, whichever it is, so that what happens, the same road can be used by both opposite people. Like for example, I go on my left side, the person who is coming in the opposite direction goes on the right side, on his left side. That means basically that we are not clashing between. So we are using the same road. It's a very simple, convenient say that the laws are made. And human being has all these laws, rules and regulations, so that the life becomes comfortable, life becomes orderly. This is something which is very important in our life, so that we can use it. In fact, different countries have different kind of things. Like for example, in America, everybody goes on the right, so that you go on the right side, and he goes on his right side, so that the traffic will be comfortable. The same thing in England, everybody goes on the left side, so that in London, when you see that, the traffic is going on very smoothly on either side. But in India, people go in the middle of the road. We don't have anything like that. Wherever there is place that you go, slowly now we are coming to that level there, we also try to follow. But the most important thing is that laws are given by the society, laws are given by the world outside. But the most important aspect is that if somebody does not follow, then we have to have law enforcement instruments, etc., all those things. Whereas just imagine, the law comes from within, then everything will be set in normal way. You don't have to have police, you don't have to have lawyers, you don't have to have courts to decide about law. Law should come from within. This is an extraordinary, wonderful piece of information that our scriptures always say, that the laws that are there, let it come from within. In the sense that, if you are a citizen, know the law. Law belongs to you. It is not that you belong to the law. Law belongs to you. You have to be proud of that particular thing. But look at the way, how many times people do not follow that. I was going in Chicago. A friend of mine was driving me. Middle of the night, 1 o'clock, we were coming back from some seminar. And then absolutely, there were in a suburban part of Chicago, absolutely there was no traffic, nobody, no vehicles, no nothing. And then we were only the vehicle which are going on the road. And he came to the stop sign and he stopped the car, looked either side and then went ahead. I asked him, why did you stop? He said, because there is a stop sign. Yeah, there is a stop sign, I have also seen. But then why did you stop? He said, well, the rule is there that wherever the stop sign is there, you stop it. Then I asked him, why the rule is there? Then he said, hey, you know, if the vehicles are coming in opposite direction, then you clash. But there are no vehicles in the opposite direction, absolutely no other vehicle, why didn't you stop it? He got a little more irritated. He said, if it don't stop, police will catch you and give you a ticket. Take and cancel your license. I said, there is no police also, why didn't you stop it? Then he just stopped the car and then get out of the car. He said, why? You are asking too many questions. You see, law is there, it said that law belongs to me. It does not belong to police, it does not belong to traffic, it does not belong to anybody else. Law belongs to me. I follow the law. That's why if you accept my following the law, get into the car. You see, I'm so happy about that. Somebody would say that law belongs to me. We feel that violation of the law is something like a rule of law. Unfortunately, that should not be the way. law should come from within. In fact, if you want to become a good citizen, allow the laws of the citizen or the laws of the society come from within. Like wherever I come, I go to the temple, there are certain rules and regulations in the temple. Let me own that because it's my own temple. I've come to Prashanti, Prashanti has some certain rules and regulations. Discuss about that, that's okay. But the most important thing, once it is there, it belongs to us. Let us be proud of these things. In fact, why I say that is, a society where, psychologists say, a society where a number of disciplines are there in the society, that society suffers from less of the psychological aberrations. In fact, it makes you psychologically strong. Why? Because the simple thing is that if I have to follow the law, that means to say I should have that inner strength within me which owns that law. Every law that makes me strong and I don't follow the law, that means to say I'm internally becoming weak. My soul is becoming weak. This is only the idea. But then we go one step ahead, that there are certain things which are further disciplines, deeper than these things, to see that how we can go to a higher level. And that's what is basically dharma. Dharma does not violate the law. Dharma does not violate the nyaya. It fulfills the nyaya and rises above the level of nyaya. And how do we say that? You follow the dharma. Dharma basically includes dana, daya. All these things are supposed to be dharma. Like for example, I give the charity. This is supposed to be dharma. And I do the fasting. This is part of dharma. Now look at the difference between the nyaya and dharma. Nyaya says whatever that you have, you eat it. You are not violating any law. You are not violating anything. That you have, whatever that you have, with that you eat. This is what simply what nyaya says, what is the law says. And no court can punish me if I eat food that I have legitimately earned. But then what is dharma says? Dharma says today is Ekadashi, let me not eat food. It's your own cooked food, your own earned food. But why do you want to do that? You see, it rises above that level. In fact, let me give you a few examples to show that how dharma takes care of nyaya, that's what is law, and rises above that. Like when Rama was supposed to be coronated, all the arrangements are getting made because it was so suddenly decided, next day Rama will be coronated. When all the preparations are going on, when everything was so busy, at that time suddenly you know what happened. Manthara put her foot down saying that she poisoned Kaikeyi's mind, and Kaikeyi and demanded on Dasharatha saying that Rama should go to the forest. Now at that point of time Rama was busy somewhere else, and then he was summoned and Rama came running, and then he saw Dasharatha on the ground, and then Kaikeyi there, and then Kaikeyi told Rama, your dad wants to tell you something, but then he is sick, he is not doing well, he is not in a position to express himself, so on his behalf I am going to tell you. And then Rama, this is something which is very serious, so why don't you just have a cup of water and sit down, relax, so that I am going to tell you something which is serious. Rama said, what is it? He said, you know, all that background that is there, that there is, your father owes me two boons, and then one of the boons that I asked him is to send you forest for 14 years. So you are going to forest for 14 years. Today itself. You know what is Rama's reaction to that? He says, Mother, it's okay, I'm going to the forest, but you said something serious? That means it's not even serious to him. Now let me come to that. Later on, what happened is that Rama goes to Kausalya and then there's Lakshmana. And then Lakshmana's wife, Urmila, and also Sita, they were all there. And then they were excited, they didn't know about this. And then they said, Rama, is the preparation going on well? Rama said, no, no, I'm going to fast. And this is what happened. At that time, the discussion that goes on between Lakshmana and Rama. Lakshmana takes the position of Nyaya, position of law. And Rama, look at Rama's stand, which is far beyond that. And what is that? Lakshmana says, Rama, you don't have to go to the forest just because that, you know, the rule of law is that the eldest of the kingdom should get the kingdom. Eldest of the king, eldest of the son should get the kingdom, so therefore kingdom belongs to you. No personal agenda should come in between the greater agenda called the kingdom. So therefore, and whatever the Kaikeyi asked, it's a personal agenda between Kaikeyi and Dasharatha, it did not interfere. You see, what a wonderful law point here Lakshmana brings about. And second law point Lakshmana brings about is, you know what is that? Dasharatha is not well, he is sick, and therefore that he has said like that. No, no, you don't have to follow that. Let us first of all take him to medical exam, and after that we will decide, but let's not be in a hurry. You know, these days most of the politicians, when they are supposed to go, first thing is that they go to the hospital. So that's second thing. And then the third is a democratic rule that he brings about, and that's what is also love. People are the people who are being subjects are the, to be subjects, and they are to be ruled. Let them decide who they want you to be the king, they want me to be the king. Like whether, let us go to the vote tomorrow, whether they want Bharata to be the king or Rama, you be the king. And automatically, obviously, the people choose you to be the king, so you don't have to go to the forest. It's a democratic law. And then the last one is Kshatra Dharma, Kshatra law, which is this, that according to Kshatriya, that they, I am strong, so that, you know, let Bharata come with whole army, let us fight that army, whoever wins will take over the kingdom. So therefore you don't have to go to the forest. See, look at all these points, they are the positions of law. But then Rama says one particular stand, he says that Bharat, Lakshmana, you don't know the ways of dharma. Dharma is beyond all these laws. I am going to the forest. What is the dharma? Whatever that father says, I follow that. This is what the dharma that we are learning here. Mitu, Matur Devo Bhava, Pitur Devo Bhava, Acharya Devo Bhava, Atithi Devo Bhava. What is that? That means to say, father says it is the word and I need to follow that. So Rama follows the ways of dharma. So much that he follows the ways of dharma, that when he goes to the forest and there Bharata along with all those people, they come and request Rama, Rama please come back. Because the father died, nobody is there in the kingdom, you need to take over the kingdom. Rama says, Bharata, you are good enough to take over the kingdom, let me follow the dharma. That is, I have given word to the father. Just because father is not there, it does not mean my dharma, I can walk over my dharma, I'll have to still follow my dharma. This is what is dharma, nishtha Rama. That's why we say, Rama is a dharma. Dharma is given. In spite of the fact, and you surrender, you give it. This is what is the idea of dharma. We have such examples that are there. Like what is the law says? Shatam pratishatyam. If somebody meets you, then you meet him. Somebody gives you a slap, you give him a slap. This is what everybody is following in Rome. And this was what everybody following in those days. And then here one man comes onto the scene, and then he showed the other cheek. When somebody came on one cheek, he showed the other cheek. Everybody was surprised. He said, what is this man? He is something extraordinary. See, that means if he would have hit somebody else, then it would have just like a street fight. There is nothing extraordinary. But when Jesus showed the other cheek, he became extraordinary. Ordinary people, they follow the law, that's fine. But dharma is somebody who is above the level of law. And that's what is extraordinary thing about dharma. Dharma fulfills law and goes beyond the level of law. Let me give another hypothetical example. Like simple thing is that I'm an engineer and my wife is a doctor, so we can earn a lot of money. Amass money, wealth, all those things. And then nobody can find fault with us. Huge mansion, huge bungalow, everything. Nobody can find fault with us because it's legitimately earned money. I mean, I'm paying all the taxes, I'm doing all those things. I'm a good citizen. And I follow all those things. And a festival like Diwali comes, I have one son. And then I give all my wealth to see that how lavishly that we can celebrate Diwali. It's a 3-day festival, every day fresh clothes, every day this thing, and lot of crackers, lot of nice wonderful food. Nothing wrong about that. But look at the way Diwali festival is the festival that I'm going to create a Brahmin and then offer him some food and all that. Whereas at that same time, my next door neighbor is a high school teacher. Has 4 children. It's a hypothetical example. And you know how the society is. Doctor, engineer are very lavish. when his high school teacher is paid part-time, but he is doing so much of work, he teaches so much of, he prepares so many people for the future generation, and all those things are there, and then he gets such a little money. And with that little money, how can he manage four children? Festival comes, it's festival for me, but it's a curse on him. Because he can give clothes to one person, he cannot give clothes to the other child, he cannot give clothes to anybody. And in our house, we are burning the crackers, and they are looking at this from outside. And those children do not possess all those things. At that point of time, look at the way that how dharma tries to bring about a harmony with the society between the high and low, between rich and poor, and all those things. The dharma says that on a festival like Deepavali, that you should invite people, Brahmins, and then give them food, give them clothing. This is as per the injunction. If I simply say to the next door neighbor, you come to our house and I give you some food and some of this thing, his Swabhimana will get hurt. He says that, look, I'm not here like a beggar. I earn my money. I may be poor, but I cannot take money from you. But on the other hand, I can say that, look, this is according to the dharma. You cannot deny it. You should come to my house. You take food. You make, and I give clothes, not only for you, the whole family, and the children will participate in the children, burning the crackers. Now you see that I pass on. If you look at it, the hidden agenda behind it is, I give. This is what is the idea of dharma. In dharma that you give, therefore basically, essential features of dharma is the self-control, dhamma, and dana, you give it. And you show your compassion, daya, these are all the things which make the dharma. So dharma is, you are taking care of law, you are living in this world, you are not running away from this world, but at the same time that you are incorporating these principles in your day-to-day life, that's what is dana, daya, and dhamma. If you do that, that's what is basically the idea of dharma. So dharma is something which is extraordinary, and this is the concept that we brought about. Look at the amount of sincerity that we follow. Like people give dana, they may not have anything, but then still that they give dana. Because basically that is the part of dharma. And the about dhamma, self-control, nigraha, is so much, it may be an ekadashi day, or it may be something like that. On that day that you may be marrying your own son, your own daughter, you invited thousands of people to partake in the food, and all those things are there. I have seen such parents who do all this kind of thing and then take care everybody is fed properly, but at the same time, when are you having food? He said, no, no, today is Ekadashi. It's a day of fasting. I won't take food. Wow, what an amount of control that they have. Now, what is these things? What are these things? Wonderful food is there. Your own prepared food, and then you are offering to everybody else. Everybody is having it, but you don't have it. Food is ready. You don't have it. What is that which can control you? It's not that even if you have food, steal food somewhere and then have it. Nobody finds fault with you, that's okay. But in spite of it, what you do it, what is controlling it is, my inner consciousness is controlling me. My conscience is controlling me. If I follow the traffic light where the police is not there, nobody else is there, and then I can even go, nobody finds fault with me. In spite of it, I say, let me stop here, follow the will, go ahead. Who is doing that? It is that willpower that is there within me, conscience, which is doing that. Therefore, every practice of dharma is that which it looks from outside, it is trying to give away, parting away with your riches. It may be like that you are showing your compassion, going extra mile away to show your compassion. Or maybe that you are following your self-control, discipline. It is what is seen outside. But what is happening inside is every practice of dharma is strengthening your inner consciousness and in your inner conscience. That means to say your willpower is increasing. You are becoming closer to a level where object outside need not disturb you, agitate you. You know, many times what people do not understand this principle, they do upavasa. Like, you know, one of the very simple idea is, recently I went to somebody's house and then I was, they, parents went to Kashi, and when you go to the Kashi, you have to give up something. And then what is that? The parents have gone there and then gave up something like, you know, one fruit and one this thing, and one fruit is supporter they have given up. And then another chiku, and then another vegetable that they have to give up, and something like rindi they have given up. And then the children were crying, saying that, look, ever since my parents went to Kashi, in our house no bhindi is made, no chiku is available. What is this? That means to say, real control is that all those things are there in the house. You cook yourself bhindi, you cook, you have support of everybody, but you don't take it. Object is there, but then willpower is something which is much more than the object outside. This is what is dharma. The benefit of dharma is that which can make you stronger inside. And this is the only country, this only culture where we have so many such disciplines of dharma which will make us to be internally strong, our willpower strong. If you have a strong willpower, nothing else can disturb you. Today, look at all of these kind of disorders that we have, part of the lifestyle disorders. What is that lifestyle? And people go and eat indiscriminately. People go and live a life indiscriminately. That means to say there is no willpower. And many times we also have willpower. In the night when we go to bed, after going back from Prashanti, people will say that the night when we go to bed, yes, tomorrow morning I have to get up at 5 o'clock and do my yoga. I should follow the same routine. I should read Bhagavad Gita like the way Prashanti we do it. We have a lot of willpower at the night when we make a decision. But when you get up in the morning, there is that willpower. It's inside the cupboard. You get up at 7 o'clock. 5 o'clock, it says suddenly, it's still raining, still cold. How can I get up and do yoga? Finish. Willpower is that which belongs to you, not belong to morning and evening, not belong to something else. The more and more that you try to practice these disciplines, the more and more that you practice compassion, the more and more that you practice charity of life, then what happens is basically that you are running to the world outside or the object outside for your happiness, that comes down. And that's what the most important thing is. Two things that we get, that you find joy in yourself. If you find somebody who is doing fasting and then you look at his face, he's miserable, he's losing his joy, that means he's not doing fasting at all. As somebody is really fasting where joy has not one inch come down, that means he's finding the joy within himself. Therefore, what is dharma? Dharma is that it gives you freedom from the attachment to the object outside. Objects are there. And also gives you the freedom that happiness is your own nature inside. It's not the object outside. That happiness which is there inside our nature, we call it as bliss. There's only difference between the happiness and bliss, ananda and santosha. And whatever that object uses, we say that that is what is happiness. But without object, but you still have that experience of ananda, that's what we call it as bliss. So, dharma is essentially a plan, a scheme, a technology which can take you to that freedom inside, the bliss inside, which freedom and inside, bliss inside is what is called as moksha. Therefore, artha kama, pursuit of the object outside, desire for the object inside, that's what is kama and artha. When you put them together in the field of dharma, with the ideas of dharma, definitely you are not caught up in the object outside, but you get the freedom. So artha kama, when you passes through dharma, will give you the moksha, the freedom. The concept of this freedom, moksha, is there in our culture. We belong to that extraordinary, wonderful culture of ours, India, Bharat, which has given this for 10,000 years, this whole wonderful concept of dharma. So deep inside, the nature of the water is to flow downwards, the nature of the stone is to be strong, the nature of the fish is to swim in the water, the nature of the bird is to fly in the air. When you come to that level, what is the nature of human being? The singular human being nature is internally that we have the freedom within us. Moksha is our own nature. Thank you.